चहल साहब, मुझे आपकी आज याद आ रही थी क्योंकि वीएन दत्ता साहब गुजर गए। आपने पढ़ा होगा पेपर में, तो मुझे अभी भी हमें पता नहीं चला है कि हमारे इंस्टीट्यूट का हिस्सा रहे कि नहीं, क्योंकि उनकी दो वॉल्यूम की बहुत महत्वपूर्ण किताब है ना, पंजाब डिस्टर्बेंसेस पर, हंटर कमिटी रिपोर्ट, और 1970 में छापी थी। बट आई डोंट नो वेदर ही डिड द वर्क एज एन IIS फेलो और नॉट। So if you can find out, if you know somebody, because he was at Kurukshetra, he was the head of department. So please find out if you can. I tried to write to Poonam Datta, his daughter, Poonam and Monica. I know both of them. No jawab nahi aaya. He was 94 years old, you know, and still active. Halanki, I think he had Parkinson's or something when I met him about 7-8 years ago, उनको चलने में बहुत दिक्कत हो रही थी। Anyhow, तो अगर आप if you find out and if there's some official link with IIS, then we'll do a condolence. Anyhow, so friends, we have gathered today to listen to Dr. Pavitra Nambiar, and I missed his first presentation, but I have his very detailed recommendations also about what to do with regard to the insurgency in the northeast. So those are you know, very valuable, and we are still trying to find the right channels because they don't in a way constitute a part of his work, so they are in a way confidential. So we are still trying to see if the government can benefit from his perspective, from his analysis, and from his findings. But when it comes to this topic and his research work, culture, corruption and insurgency, threats and quest for survival in Nagaland, I was reading your abstract, sir, with a lot of interest, and I found that you've tried to combine some empirical analysis, gathering data using SPSS and other, as you said, relational content analysis, factor analysis, to understand power, distance. So those who do this kind of mathematical regressions in social studies will appreciate that method. I don't know too much about it. I'm more of the qualitative than quantitative type of person in trying to understand material. But nevertheless, he has studied the responses of more than 142 people, I think, and also done extensive field work. And the findings, you know, I find them very interesting. He says that there are kinship and social bonds which in some ways get embedded, you know, in the modern systems and state structures of Nagaland. And somehow they seem to promote corruption. However, in this abstract, neither corruption nor culture are defined. But he says, for example, that he found 75% of the respondents, they agree that illegally favoring family and clan members is routine. So 75% are saying that. And what I found very interesting is that high respect is given for those who make money illegally, you know, and those who take government jobs and make a lot of money, they are given a lot of respect. Then he says that 72% of his respondents agree that corruption, in, you know, encourages insurgency. So he's, so there is a three-pronged thrust, I think, in your work. So there is culture, and there is a correlation between culture and corruption, and then between corruption and insurgency. I think this is the causal argument chain that he's making. And then he says, very interestingly in chapter 4, that there's a lot of dissatisfaction and disconnect between the people and the government. So there's a huge trust deficit, you know. And then there is a contradictory response, I think he's getting, which is that people are expecting the government to take steps to minimize corruption. So on the one hand, you know, respondents are saying that those who are corrupt are highly regarded socially, you know. And if you do not favor your clan once you take office, then in the clan your prestige goes down. This is what he has found. You know, but then at the same time, people expect the government to be clean and want to reduce corruption also. And then there are a lot of policy recommendations. So I don't want to take up too much time, but the question that arose in my mind, as I'm sure will arise in your mind, is why is this only for Nagaland? Isn't this true for most of India, that you assume office to favor your cronies or those who have promoted you, and public institutions are expected to be subverted for private profit or power? This is expected. It's almost as if the public is meant for private good, almost taken for granted. And if you do not do that, you're regarded, you know, with hostility and surprise. Ki kahan se ye banda pahunch gaya, you know? Khud nahi khata, humko bhi nahi khane deta, you know? You know, this is the culture, it would seem. So is the culture restricted to Nagaland, or is it endemic, you know, to India? This is the question. And then favoring one's clan, one's family, one's community, the tribalism. We have experts on Indian constitution, federalism, government, and they can tell us how tribalism is so much a part of Indian democracy. Many parties are family parties in India, and several members of the family get elected and hold ministerial office. And if clans and castes and families are not favored after coming to government, they lose prestige, they lose face. You know, and people even ask, aapne kuch kaam nahi karna tha hamare liye, to humne aapko kyun chuna? Ye to sawal puche jaate hain. So we'll have to make certain distinctions, in my view, between say the Northeast or Nagaland, which has a higher percentage of tribal populations, and the rest of India, where tribalism still persists. Okay, and then if you look at the larger culture, you see, you know, what is the correlation between culture and corruption? Okay, is there a culture of corruption, or is there a corruption of culture? You know, it's a chicken and egg situation. Which comes first? Because there is also a culture of honesty, which is thousands of years old in the constitution and in hamare jo chin hai, Ashok chin, usme kehte hain satyameva jayate. Now, does it mean we are a nation of hypocrites? So these are deep, deep questions, you know, of how institutions are systematically subverted and to what end. And this has been going on for quite some time. It's not something new. And then, of course, the question, how do you change that culture? What are the mechanisms of change? You know? Is it through education? Is it through modernization? You know, or is it through some sort of cleansing, which is based on some, you know, eternal ideas or principles that some people want to show us? You know, they're saying, you know, saaf niyat, sahi vikas, you know, things like that. Hamari niyat ganga jaisi pavitra. Okay. Now, this association of Ganga, which itself is highly polluted these days, but I mean, so we have to look at culture in a very deep way, as a source of change, as a source of dynamism, as a source of transformation. At the same time, as a river can also be polluted, culture can also be polluted through continuous subversion, continuous hypocrisy, and so forth. So, and in other words, when you now apply it back to Nagaland, there must be some sources, some elements in traditional Naga culture and society, you know, which can help change the dynamic of either corruption or insurgency. And how do you harness those? For example, tribal cultures, as anthropologists tell us, have a very high premium on loyalty. So now, you know, when you see the negotiations between, you know, some of these insurgent groups and the government, and I mean, I'm a reader of novels and so forth. I've read some novels, you know, Estherin and other people, and they always say, this was the deal that was made. And so, either the center or whoever the government, they did not keep their word. So keeping your word, you know, loyalty to some principles. So those are also elements of culture. Now, can those be harnessed? So these are questions I had in my mind. So thank you so much. And Anjali ji, please take over. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming today. I also thank Professor Paranjpe for sharing his valuable insight on the project of Dr. Nambiar. Right at the outset, I accept my limitations to fully comprehending his work. However, the abstract reflects a promising project and that he has based his work and conclusions on primary data, which he will soon share with us. But before I request Dr. Nambiar to begin his presentation, let me briefly read his bio data. He has put in 39 years service in Gujarat Police, like more than my age, and had worked in various divisions like Intelligence Bureau, CID, Crime and Railways, Reserve Police, Communication and Police Research. He has secured his PhD from Gujarat University and has 15 publications to his credit, including books, chapters in books and articles. His areas of interest are policing, intelligence, counterterrorism, and U.S. Homeland Security. He received the prestigious President's Police Medal for Meritorious Service. He is the only police officer from India who got selected as a fellow at the Police Foundation, Washington, D.C., where he produced a paper titled Radicalization of Islam, a Historical Perspective and Homegrown Threat to the U.S. He has also worked as an assistant professor and head of the Department of Homeland Security and Anti-Terrorism at Gujarat Forensic Sciences University, Gandhinagar. His topic of study at IIS, as we all know, is culture, corruption and insurgency, threats and quests for survival in Nagaland. So he has come to academics and scholarship from the field with inverted commas. Perhaps his first-hand experience of things and situations in his long career must have allowed him to comprehend an insurgency as no other hermeneutic practice or training would. It would have provided him with a different kind of lens to view things, which in my experience with individuals from the forces, that they usually view situations in the realm of black and white, or right and wrong, allowing a few or no gray areas. With these words, I welcome Dr. Nambiar to share his research with us. I'm excited to listen to you, sir, and understand your lens. So we have 1 hour, 15 minutes in your hand. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon to one and all. Before I begin, I'll answer to Professor Paranjpe's question. One, I have not defined culture and corruption in this abstract and the handout. Yes, I did not, because that was done earlier in my last presentation. Then you have a question that corruption, that is not only limited to Nagaland. It is a menace that we can see all over India and all over the world. Then what is the specialty with Nagaland? My answer is, corruption is there in other states, but there is no insurgency in those states. It means that level of corruption is less, one thing. Second thing, no state has made any agreement with any insurgent group to give certain amount of state funds to the insurgents. So that is what makes the insurgency in Nagaland special from the insurgency, sorry, from corruption in other states. So, with this answer, now I will start my presentation. Friends, last year, after I made my presentation, I felt that I would have discussed something more in detail about my research methodology. When we talk of research methodology, yes, it can be qualitative study, it can be quantitative study. We use secondary data and we use primary data. if it is a, generally what we see is that if it is a qualitative study, the entire study will be dependent on that method only. Otherwise, it will be quantitative study. But in my case, I have used both. Why? To authenticate the finding of one with the other. Because what happens is that the audience may think he has got these findings. How can he authenticately say that, yes, this is true or false? So for this purpose, I have done both. Yes. Okay. So, yeah, what I did was, it's okay. I was going through the literature in the beginning, I'm talking, and I identified 41 literature which discusses about culture, corruption, and insurgency in Nagaland. After that, from those 41 literature, I identified 24 variables, the variables which have got hidden meaning, that either there is a relation between culture and corruption, or there is a relationship between corruption and insurgency. Thereafter, the frequency of the variables were found, then using Pearson's correlation, relation between different variables were found out, and fine analysis was done. This is what I did as far as secondary data analysis is concerned. This study started with the question, is there any relationship between culture and corruption in government offices in Nagaland? And what is the link between corruption and insurgency in the state? Yes, this is a pioneer study in this domain. Research methodology is very important to prove the relationship. So, analysis of both secondary data as well as primary data is used to authenticate the findings. Now, why I consider this as a pioneer study? Because I have not come across any study that dealt with the relationship between culture and corruption insurgency as far as India is concerned. So that is the reason. Then research methodology, first, as I mentioned, secondary data was collected from 41 relevant literature by identifying pertinent texts, opinions, statements, features, phrases, concepts, and words that directly or indirectly implied that the Naga culture has got a link with corruption in government offices. From these, 24 specific variables were selected, which have got the above meanings, found the frequency of the variables, and interpreted using relational content analysis method. By using Pearson's correlation coefficient, relationship between variables was established. Factor analysis method was used to reduce the large number of variables into fewer number of factors. Further, to examine whether the findings have got any relationship with off-stage cultural dimension of power distance, located relevant statements and opinions, etc., and formulated 6 themes that showed the relationship between culture and corruption insurgency in Naga society. This further justified the prevalence of disparity in the society and its acceptance by the people. Now, as far as power distance is concerned, I will briefly discuss later. So, after this exercise, this is the kind of report that I got. You can see variables and its interpretation. As I told, 24 variables were identified and its meanings are mentioned in the right column. In brief, I can say that this was concept categorization was done in this way. Thereafter, as I told, the frequency of the variables was found out. You can see culture, it occurred 1,597 times. Then corruption, that appeared 1,502 times. So in this way, the frequency of all the 24 variables was found out. Then its mean and standard deviation was found out. Then this you can't see, it's not clear because it's a very big table. Now Pearson's correlation was used to identify the relationship between different variables. Here on certain figures, you can see that there will be 1 star or 2 star. 1 star means it is significant, 2 star means it is highly significant. Then factor analysis. After the Pearson's correlation coefficient was done, then factor analysis was done to identify, so it gave me 6 components that you can see on the right side. There are 6 components. Why it is done? Each component, what is the relationship between each component and those 24 variables? This is the table. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Means those are the components. And on the left side, 24 variables are there. So component number 1, it has got relationship with the, actually I can see from here. See those in different colors, red. Then in the second component column, there is green, it is mentioned in green color, and in third column it is in blue color. It means those have got relationship with the variables mentioned towards that. In this way, 6 components were identified. So yes, this is the way how I analyzed the reports that I got as far as secondary data is concerned. And thereafter, on the basis of that, its analysis was done. This is okay. ठीक है. This one. Okay, leave it. I'll explain. I say it on it. Yeah. So, after doing the analysis of secondary data, I wanted to analyze the primary data. Primary data, yes, during the last winter break, I had been to Nagaland and in the field and collected data. So interview schedule was prepared with 5-point Likert scale answers and administered to the academicians, students, and government employees, total 143, during the field work in Nagaland. The data was analyzed using SPSS and found its mean, standard deviation, skewness, kurtosis, chi-square, and p-value. And the results were incorporated with the findings of secondary data, which made the outcome of the study more authentic. Moreover, discussions were held with officials of different security agencies, and their versions were incorporated at appropriate places. So, as far as primary data is concerned, this is the kind of format that came out. You can see there, as I told, 5-point Likert scale, the 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that is strongly agree, agree, can't say, disagree, strongly disagree. And then its mean, standard deviation, skewness, kurtosis, chi-square, and p-value was found. So in total, here I have, for example, I have given a statement. People have accepted corruption as a way of life. So similarly, in total, 24 statements were administered to the respondents. So in addition to that, 6 open-ended questions were also given to the respondents, in which open-ended questions, they can give their opinion on their own. So this was the method that I used as far as primary data is concerned, and from the reports, its analysis was done. So this is as far as my research method is concerned. Now I will come to the findings of this study and findings of the study, and I will read out the chapter wise. I will read out. Chapter 1, that is introduction. Chapter 2, in-depth analysis of the secondary data revealed that certain cultural elements have positive relationship with corruption in government offices in Nagaland. What happened was that the kinship and social bonds got embedded with corruption in public offices, and this operated as a vicious cycle, both strengthening each other. Analysis of the secondary data also shows that there prevailed the power distance in the society. What is power distance? Power distance is a part of Hofstede's cultural dimension theory and defined as the extent to which the less powerful members of institutions and organizations within a country expect and accept that power is distributed unequally. This refers to the degree to which individuals, groups, or societies accept inequalities as unavoidable, legitimate, or functional. In short, it is the impact of a society's culture on the values or attitudes of its members. Needless to say that there is a strong bond among the members of family and clan among Nagas. Now I will come to the primary data. Analysis of primary data collected during the fieldwork in Nagaland showed that corruption was practiced in government offices. The family clan members believed and did support their own men working in public offices and involved in wrong practices like corruption, etc., and justified them. There is reciprocation too. Their culture obligates the government officials to help same family clan members even by misusing official power, and the custom is such that the officials not doing illegal favors to his family clan lost his prestige in his clan. The study shows that pumping in of huge funds led by the prevalence of culture of corruption in government offices permeated in the society and has created social and economic disparity. It further shows that the vigilance and anti-corruption agency was incapable of containing corruption to a great extent. Those who accumulated wealth through any means, maybe illegal also, were given high respect in the society, and people preferred such government jobs where there was opportunity to make extra illegal money. The data further shows that the people have accepted corruption as a way of life, and these societal maladies are a part of their culture. The strong internalization of such social customs and pressures are some of the reasons that encourage the government servants to get involved in corruption in different forms in their offices. Thus, relationship between culture and corruption in government offices can be seen here. Now let us see what some of the respondents said. In spite of the prevalence of culture of corruption, people do not come out in the open to speak against it, which led to a culture of silence. During the fieldwork, one of the senior professors said, "The culture of corruption in government offices has strong relationship with the culture of silence that encourages corruption in different forms." According to her, the culture of silence emanates primarily due to two reasons. One, fear of the powerful, and two, the community dictum. In the first situation, there is an element of fear in the minds of common people towards the powerful. They knew that the powerful could do anything with their money and political power. They have seen or heard from others how these elites exercised their power that created fear in the minds of common people. As such, Nagas were humble and simple, but this kind of situation forced them to be submissive to those who are authoritative. In the second situation, there is community dictum to support people of their clan even if they did wrongs, and this custom is practiced amongst Nagas. Hence, people blindly follow this dictum even if they find that the person whom they are supporting is wrong. Another factor supports this phenomenon is the strong clan ties, which is given high significance and thereby simply agreeing without questioning, unquote. With regard to corruption, a senior police officer lamented, "People have accepted corruption as a way of life. Earlier, Nagas were humble and honest. After the statehood, in the initial stage, the state used to surrender, that is, give back the unused money. Later on, instead of surrendering, the politicians and government officials decided to utilize the money and started preparing documents accordingly. Gradually, more demands were put forward and more money was poured in. And sharing of money between politicians, bureaucrats, officials, contractors, insurgents, and others in the hierarchical chain systematically happened. In the beginning, there was some kind of hesitation and guilty conscience among them, but the passage of time taught them that they were masters of the money and they could manipulate it the way they wanted. Gradually, they felt authority and right over such money. This attitude got embedded in their character, became a part of the culture, and could not think of doing anything without getting something in return." Unquote. Then I was eager to know whether there was any difference in the attitude of people towards corruption in cities and villages. Then I asked, "Have the villages also accepted corruption as a way of life?" To this, a former IB official said, "In the initial stage, no. But now the situation has changed. They know the quantum of money the politicians are getting. So the people started to demand money from the politicians for each vote during elections, and the politicians fulfilled their demands. It is unimaginable the money being spent by them. When a candidate spends such huge money and wins the election, he will be anxious to gather the money that was spent, as well as to accumulate it further more for spending for the next election and thus cling to power." Unquote. Here, I would like to quote Chandrika Singh, who said that there was a price for the votes. Money, war, liquor, jobs, etc. are the demands of the villages. When discussing the issue of culture and corruption with another senior police officer, he said, "Since the intra-clan ties are strong, members of that clan should not raise voice against anybody in the same clan who is involved in any illegal act or crime. If such person has accumulated huge money, even illegally, he gets high respect in his clan. Everybody disregards his wrongdoings and looks only at his money, power, and influence. Another facet of culture of corruption is that anybody donating huge funds is invited as chief guest of any function." Unquote. So, similar to the results of secondary data, findings of the primary data too showed the positive relationship between culture and corruption in Naga public offices, and both strengthen each other. Moreover, as certain cultural elements facilitated corruption in public offices, this validates the relevance of facilitation theory in the context of Nagaland. Now I will come to chapter 3. It deals with the relationship between corruption and insurgency. The secondary data analysis shows that corruption is one of the factors that strengthened insurgency in the state. This I already presented last year. Analysis of primary data shows that corruption has got linked with insurgency in the state. Huge funds poured in the state by the center have given opportunity to politicians, bureaucrats, contractors, agents, etc. to grab money. The insurgents using threat forced the government officers to spare rebel cuts for them. Additionally, collection of illegal tax, extortion, etc. helped strengthening the insurgent groups. All these show that the rampant corruption in government offices has been one of the factors that encouraged insurgency in the state. Furthermore, the insurgents have such a strong influence in the entire hierarchical chain that it makes them possible to get the documentary information about the allotment of funds to different departments and offices. Here it needs to be recalled that the NIA investigations found that the former Chief Minister T.R. Zeliang and several officials were involved in siphoning state funds to terror groups. Now, their argument was that they paid money as their lives were in danger. This shows that the state government failed in its primary duty of providing security to its citizens. Thus, corruption weakened the state machineries. While discussing the relationship between corruption and insurgency in the state, one of the senior police officers said, quote, "No government can be in power without the sympathy of the insurgent groups, and this sympathy is purchased with money. When funds are given to the state and its allocation to different departments is done, it is known to the insurgent groups. In fact, the insurgent groups are capable of procuring a copy of the fund allocation letter. Armed with this information, they contact the authorities of the concerned offices and asked to make contribution of particular amount to them. Due to fear of life, the authorities are forced to share a cut of the fund to the insurgents and accordingly manipulate the figures on paper. This way, the receipt of the funds and its expenditure are made clear in the documents. The sufferer is the project and programs for which the fund was actually meant, and hence the underdevelopment of the state. Explaining another angle of corruption in insurgency, the police officer added, the person who is dealing with the funds and siphoning a part of it to the insurgent groups diverts a precise amount into his own pockets. This is the extra amount he is getting, in addition to his entitled share. In this situation, all those benefited would secretly prefer to continue with the hype of insurgency under the garb of peace agreements. To quote another police officer, peace agreement says that the cadres have to be in their camps, but in reality, some cadres are in their camps, their leaders have become overground and enjoy luxury life. They get huge money through illegal tax collection, cuts from the government funds, extortion and several other means. The insurgents hold their budget session, wherein they decide the entity and the amounts that have to be collected. Elucidating the link between corruption and insurgency, the police officer related, quote, insurgency survives because of the financial support they get. People contribute because fear of life. Politicians, government officials, contractors, and everybody give money to insurgents due to fear for life. The insurgents have linked with every office and they get useful information from the officials. Officials take away some amount in the name of cuts to the insurgents. Illegal taxation, extortion flourish due to the failure of the government to take any stern action. As everybody in the hierarchical chain is benefited, there is no political will to control the insurgency. So, similar to the results of the secondary data, analysis of primary data too shows that corruption in public offices is one of the factors that strengthened insurgency in the state. Now, chapter 4 dealt with the connectedness between government and people in Nagaland. Government failed to a large extent in its primary responsibility of ensuring security and welfare to its people, as we have seen in chapter 2 and 3. And these caused dissatisfaction and disconnect amongst the people towards the government. Common people were compelled to submit to the prevailing situation, as there was no alternative with them. What the primary data show? People expect that the government takes steps to minimize corruption in public offices, contain insurgency, execute developmental programs, initiate welfare measures for bettering their lives, and maintain transparency and accountability in its work. However, the analysis shows that the government proved to be partially incapable of controlling corruption, illegal tax collection and extortion thrived and failed to fulfill the aspirations of the people. Though a few respondents believe that the state government has taken steps to minimize corruption in government offices, only a meager think that the government succeeded in its efforts, that is only 4%. Similarly, the civic organizations too succeeded only marginally in controlling corruption. At most, a few respondents believe that the government has taken steps to prevent extortion and illegal tax collection. In the same way, just a handful of respondents believe that the policies of the central and state governments have helped in confidence building between them and the people. In short, majority of the respondents believe that the government and its machineries have not taken any step to improve the relationship between the government and the common people. They suffer due to the lack of developments, welfare measures, and live under threats, and all this led to a big gulf between the government and its people. They submitted to the prevailing situation as they could not find any other way. To quote Frederick, corruption in government adversely affects development, and if the government officials entrusted their responsibility to work for public interest are abusing their power for their personal gains, the citizens will lose trust in their government. Further, the successive reports of the Comptroller and Auditor General have authenticated the prevalence of massive corruption in public offices in the state. Chapter 5, Counterinsurgency Theoretical Perspective. This I have not given in my abstract or in the handout because at that time this wasn't completed. Now, what this says, this is about the theoretical perspective related to counterinsurgency. This chapter deals with COIN, counterinsurgency, short form, operation models in the US and India. An important difference in the COIN operations by both these nations is that the US has carried out its coin operations mainly outside the US, like Vietnam, Iraq, Afghanistan, and so on. On the other hand, Indian security forces had its coin experiences inside the country, except one, that is in Sri Lanka. Counterinsurgency is primarily a strategy to defeat guerrilla fighters who hide among civilian populations over an extended period of time. The main concern of counterinsurgency efforts should be to influence the behavior and action of the populace rather than their loyalty and attitudes. Here, the focus was to identify ways in which common people can be influenced so that they do not extend any support to the insurgents. The Vietnam War convinced the US to bring changes in its coin policy due to the high cost it had to bear at the domestic front. They had to suffer loss of large number of military personnel, national economy was impacted very badly, social security was disturbed, and there was political instability. All these forced the nation to adopt a low profile approach towards coin thereafter. This made the then President Richard Nixon realize to help another nation fight the war, but not to fight the war for them, and laid down three principles as guidelines for future American policy toward Asia. First, the United States will keep all of its treaty commitments. Second, it shan't provide a shield if a nuclear power threatens the freedom of a nation allied with them or of a nation whose survival US considers vital to their security. Third, in cases involving other types of aggression, the US shall furnish military and economic assistance when requested in accordance with the treaty commitments. But the US shall look to the nation directly threatened to assume the primary responsibility of providing the manpower for its defense. According to the US Army's Field Manual 3242, coin includes tactical planning, intelligence development and analysis, training, material technical organization assistance, advice, infrastructure development, tactical level operations, and information engagement. Coin operations are a combination of offensive, defensive, and stability operations. Offensive operations focus on eliminating the insurgents. Defensive operations focus on protecting the populace and infrastructure from insurgent attacks. And stability operations focus on addressing the root causes that allowed to insurgency to come into existence. The manual discusses mainly three theories. Robert Thompson's five principles for successful counterinsurgency based on the experience in Malaya. Second, David Galula's four laws for successful counterinsurgency based on the experience in Indochina and Algeria. And third, Charles Caldwell's ideas for successful counterinsurgency based on the experience in World War and other British imperial operations. The aforesaid field manual also discusses different but coordinated lines of effort, that is LOE, during counterinsurgency, like establish civil security, establish civil control, support host national security forces, support governance, restore essential services, support economic and infrastructure developments, conduct information engagement, etc. Now coming to India, principally there are two types of insurgencies in India, that is secessionist and non-secessionist. The insurgent groups demanding separation from India falls in the former category, for example Nagaland. On the other hand, there is non-secessionist insurgency that demands restructuring of the present governance or destabilize the government and to replace with a new system as per the missions of the insurgent groups. This way, they want to fulfill the aspirations of the people and eradicate inequality from the society. Nationalism in the Red Corridor region is an apt example where the left-wing extremists fight for replacing the democratically elected government. Insurgency in Nagaland was highly influenced by Mao Zedong's ideologies. Mao believed violence and support from the masses were necessary for the achievement of a peaceful communist order. A revolution is an insurrection, an act of violence by which one class overthrows another. The Revolutionary War is a war of the masses. It can be waged only by mobilizing the masses and relying on them. Political power grows out of the barrel of a gun, the gun being a metaphor for the military. The Nationalist Socialist Council of Nagaland, that is NSCN, was established on the doctrines of Mao. Quoting Rahmatullah, Kotwal mentions, The NSCN has been carrying on an armed struggle to bring an end to Indian sovereignty over the Naga people and to establish a People's Republic of Nagaland based on Mao's ideology. In India, the coin agencies adopted and still adopt both population-centric as well as enemy-centric approaches depending on the situation. In the former, the focus is on the way in which control is being exercised on the population and the environment, like physical, human and informational. Using different sources, efforts are made to bring changes in the perception and approach of the people in support of the government and its agencies by sincerely implementing developmental programs and welfare measures. On the other hand, in enemy century, the primary emphasis is on defeating the enemy combatants. Here, the school of thought is that defeating the enemy will bring all other issues to normalization, whereas in people-centric approach, the concept is how to change the attitude of people in favor of the government to enable establishing peace. Further, the mode of using SWOT approach, that is SWOT, strength, weakness, opportunity, threat, in coin operations in Indian context has been elaborately discussed in this chapter. Chapter 6 is policy recommendations. This chapter has three sections. Section 1 deals with the security preparedness that has to be taken in an insurgency-infested area. Section 2 elaborates on the raising of a new counter-insurgency intelligence unit and an assault unit in all districts, its structure and functions. And Section 3 describes the model of an actual counter-insurgency operation that has to be carried out in Nagaland. Chapter 7 is the conclusion. To sum up, 1. There is positive relationship between culture and corruption in Nagaland. 2. There is positive relationship between corruption and insurgency. 3. Apart from various factors, evidence of certain cultural elements facilitating corruption and corruption facilitating insurgency show the significance of facilitation theory in the context of Nagaland. 4. The relationship between government and people is not up to the satisfactory level. 5. Power distance prevails in the society. And 6. Due to sluggishness in implementing the developmental programs and welfare measures, people suffer a lot, live under fear, and struggle between aspirations, threats, and despair. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Nambia, for your scholarly presentation. I am convinced that you have written a critical account of the insurgency in Nagaland and the corruption and the role of corruption in it, and more importantly, has documented the words of the common man who is amidst the whole crisis. Additionally, particularly with respect to corruption and its impact on society and state machinery, I agree with Professor Paranjpe that this research could also serve as a useful comparative case study to understand similar situations in other Indian states. The only difference is between the source of resources or money which they are getting. So, with this, you may ask your questions or share your feedback with Dr. Nambia.
Sir, yes.
This is Sharma.
So, I want to compliment you.
Thank you, sir.
It was really good piece of research that I have come across, particularly on.
Sorry, sir.
You have used both the data, primary as well as secondary, and these two conclusions really are based on the analysis of those data. But some questions. Come to my mind. One question is, what is the sampling method we have adopted in your research?
It is simple random sampling.
Random sampling?
Yeah.
And how about that random sampling, you must have first identified the sample, then you can come to random sampling.
Right.
So, how did you identify your sample? Whether you confine yourself only to the officers of the police and the forces, or you also went to the common man and also the insurgents areas where the people live. And because, you know, if you go to those areas, you might get a different kind of feedback on your questions. Then you have referred to some kind of funding to, there's a link between politics, insurgency, corruption. Right? You have referred to the political kind of support, and which is mutual, of course. The insurgents support politicians and politicians support the insurgents. How to break this nexus? I mean, that is what is more important. And how much premium the people of Nagaland in fact assign to the three very important values for a very stable life. One, stability, peace, and progress. How much value the people, the common man, assign to these values for the change in Nagaland? Because that is what is required. And until unless we go into the roots. And thirdly, whether you have also inquired into some kind of historical resources, how insurgency in fact has taken roots in the Northeast, whether geography, history also play some role of this insurgency, and why it is only Nagaland, because if you go to Mizoram and also Manipur, I think you will come across almost similar kind of the situations, maybe a difference of degree, but the corruption in fact is quite deep into the other states of the Northeast as well. So what I'm trying to say is that when we go to the empirical world, it is necessary to see as to how much money really goes to the insurgents. And in the insurgent groups also, there could be some dominant insurgent groups and there could be some minor insurgent groups. So can we really think of a strategy which really tries to have some support to the government from the minor insurgent groups and within the major dominant insurgent groups also? Why the dialogues are failing? You have referred to at one place that there's a distrust. There's a lack of trust between the
government and the people.
Sorry?
Government
and the people. So is it, why this distrust prevails? It is in the interest of politics also to be free of insurgency, right? So why are they not making concerted efforts to really win the trust of the people?
One by one.
Yeah. Now, your first question, it was about the methodology, how I selected the people, the respondents. It is academicians, 8%, government employees, 13%, and PG students of Nagaland University as well as Northeast Hills University in Shillong, where the Naga students are studying. So that is 79%. So if you ask me, why did you selected these kind of people? Because in my opinion, academicians, they are fully aware about the incidents that are happening, and they will be, first of all, I want to have people who are ready to respond to me. Before going to Nagaland, I called up at least 8 to 10 senior police officers. 2-3 police officers, after 2 or 3 calls, they stopped picking up my phone. When I reached over there, and I'll tell you, I have been able to talk with, just having discussion, only with 5 senior police officers, including one IB officer. All of them said that, I will discuss with you, I will talk with you, but please don't mention my name. So what their version, that was what I read. Those versions are supporting my findings of secondary data as well as primary data. It is not that just based on the discussions held with them, I have found this, came to this conclusion. So that is as far as research methodology. Then you talked about, I want to say this, insurgent groups, and there are so many small criminal groups. when they found that these insurgent groups are getting lots of money, there emerged, mushroomed, not many criminal groups. They also said that, yes, we have our own insurgent group. So similarly, there are lot many small, I would call it as criminal groups, but they themselves call them as insurgent groups. So they have, and another thing, see, why everything is happening, it is just happening out of fear for life. If it is police officers, government officials, IAS officers, politicians, whoever may be, it is just out of fear. Now, out of fear, who created that situation? You asked me whether I have referred the history of Naga insurgency, how it emerged, and also in other states. Yes, I did, but in this, that was done in my previous presentation. So the thing is that the fear, it is the fear factor. My question is, how long are you going to do with this kind of fear factor? It is more than 57 decades. It is still going on. Who is the sufferer? These criminal groups and insurgent groups, they are involved in extortion, illegal tax collection. Who is the sufferer? Common people. Because anything that is coming in Nagaland, coming from outside, if the vehicle has to enter inside the state, they have to pay tax. It is illegal tax. And the funny part is that in checkpoints, there are officials of all departments. If it is police department, it is the, you take any department, they are there. But the thing is that they have to pay this extra money, and the sufferer is the common people. You asked me, did you talk to common people? As far as my questionnaire, I didn't administer my questionnaire to those people. But yes, the problem is that the moment anybody wants to speak about insurgency, people do not want to talk. That is the kind of fear that is created over. That is why I said that about the power distance existing in the society. So, did I answer your question? Or I have gone far away?
No, it's okay. Not necessarily that you have answered every question. But what my fear is that sometimes you go to the real victim of the insurgency. We may not be able to find answers because, you know, so far as the factor of insecurity or the fear of life is concerned, is it also prevailing in the forces of dealing with the insurgency? Is it also, because in business class, this factor is very high because they give this what you call tax to the insurgents. Now, this tax is given because the sense of insecurity in the business class and trading class is very high.
Yeah.
But that may not be the case in case of the police forces or the defense forces. Why are they not able to tackle this situation?
Because everybody wants to keep the insurgency fear alive because everybody is benefited. Because the fund, for example, 50 crore funds is being allotted by the center to the state. And it goes to different offices, revenue office, health, education, all departments. All officers know that, yes, if this much money has come, I will get this much share. There is percentage decided for everybody. So the thing is that the moment this fear is not there, the center will not fund. The center will not fund. I will not get. So everybody wants to keep it alive. So that is the thing. Yes.
So maybe take questions from.
Okay. Is there anybody?
Yeah. This is Medha Ma'am's question.
Okay.
Dr. Nambiar, my question pertains to the methodology.
Okay. Variables.
What are the variables analysis?
Yes.
Let's complete this first. What are the correlations? What are the factor loadings and factor analysis? A clarification is necessary because it seems that your analysis is drawn from interpretations of the results of data you have collected. Yeah.
Yes, the protective component matrix, sometimes referred to as the loadings, is the key output of the principal components analysis. It contains estimates of the correlations between each of the variables and the estimated components. In the given table, we find that the table emphasizes that there is a strong correlation between the variables moral, ethical, feel, culture, attitude, norm, and powerful, and component one. Thus, it covers the issues of ethical, cultural, psychological, and political. So, what this show? The moral values have gone down in people's behavior. Why it has gone down? People believe that the Indian government is pumping money in Nagaland to make them feel Indian, but they consider it as the outside money and compensation for the sufferings they had at the hands of security forces in the past. So, this is about component one. Now, the correlation, the component two. The correlation between the other variables like insurgency terror, influence, internalized imbibe, etc., and the first component are very low. Normally, when interpreting a component matrix, correlations of less than 0.3 or 0.4 are regarded as being trivial. The variables like Indian, encourage, accept, respect, belong, tax store have close correlation with the second component. As seen in the first component, here it can be seen that the vindictiveness the Nagas had undergone at the hands of Indian security forces in those days has left serious injuries in their minds, and hence they do not have the inclination to be with India. No doubt, the present government is making all possible efforts within the framework of Indian constitution. However, no fruitful results could be achieved so far. The latest dialogues and finally the demands of NSC and IM to have separate flag and constitution could be a sign of the intent at the bottom of their hearts. Now coming to the component 3. The component number 3 seems to have more correlation with the variables power distance, unequal, value, practice, and attitude. Power distance is the acceptance of inequality in the society by the people, and this is a cause of several social problems. Now coming to the component number 4. The correlation between insurgency, influence, and component number 4 have close relationship. Now, component number 5, variables dishonest, illegal, and corruption have close relationship. I have its number also. And component number 6, and variables internalized, corruption, norm have close relationship. So, this is the way how 6 components have got close relationship with different variables.
There's one more question from there. This is from Dr. Kame. What is culture according to your study? Whose culture are you referring to in view of the varied cultural spectra in Nagaland? And then he has a second question as, you refer to an establishment of a state by insurgent group in the line of Mao's ideology. How do you explain this in the context of the slogan, the Nagaland for Christ, adopted by Naga insurgent group and the opposition to communist nation by Naga Christians?
Okay, he asked about what do you mean by culture. Culture means, in simple way, the way in which we live and we behave. That is the culture. That is the means rough idea of culture. All those things I have detailed discussion I have given in my previous presentation, one thing. Second thing, he is asking about of a state by insurgent group in the line of Mao's ideology. Yes, I have quoted in my presentation, I have quoted whether it is based on Mao's ideology or not. It was about the NSCN, which was established in 1980. And okay, thereafter, certainly their ideologies have changed, because after the center started to pouring in money, that moral values have gone down and they started to give more attention towards materialism, that is money. Thank you.
Professor Patel, sir, he raised his hand first.
Thank you, Dr. Nambiar. This is a vastly improved presentation from the earlier one, and I congratulate you because you have tried to bring in some important issues which have been raised during the discussion in your first presentation. And let me say, before making any comment on your presentation and your approach, that it's very difficult to work on a theme like this. And any scholar would find it extremely difficult for various reasons. And I cannot understand that. But as Professor Sharma has rightly pointed out, if you bring in history into it, then the things would start looking somewhat different. Naga problem, we are discussing and we are going to different directions, including Vietnam and America, didn't give me a right kind of vibe as far as management of this kind of problem is concerned. The Naga national issue is a very, very tricky issue, and one has to look into it very differently from a scholar who sees everything from the point of view of Indian nation state. So that is one area you will have to think about. Because I'm raising these questions because I found something very problematic in the philosophy or a theory behind your work. And that is influencing the kind of things you are saying and the way you are saying. Because you see, if you start with the notion of culture, and you have said twice way of culture, I mean, corruption as a way of life. This is a very, very problematic kind of understanding.
Sir, here, then I will forget to say what I want to say. The thing is that corruption is a way of life. The 41 literature which I referred, you can find in that. Similarly, in my primary data also, when I was talking to those people with the interview schedule which was administered to those people, they also agree with that. So that is the thing.
Let me put it this way, that if it would have been a ground report and you would have referred to some sources, then it would have been fine. But as this is a scholarly work, one has to look for a deeper understanding of the whole issue and some kind of deep engagement with the problem. And the problem itself is very, very complicated. And let me go further and say that can any culture as a way of life encourage corruption? I doubt. Any culture for that matter. Forget about Nala culture. No culture can actually facilitate corruption. And can it lead to insurgency unless some pressures come into the process from outside? Because there is a way in which you can explain that they reacted that way because of certain kind of alien pressures, and those pressures had not been dealt the way the local people would have wanted. And that could explain the way or the reasons why Nagas had reacted that way. And we have a large number of books are written on it and various kind of versions are available. But it was a very, very powerful movement. And it's still somehow being negotiated, somewhat successfully in recent years, because the power in the center is doing it in a very nuanced manner now. But earlier, there was a situation when the military might had been used to silence them, which did not prove successful. So all these things come into the play. There was a time, sir, when people used to say that Eastern cultures facilitate dictatorship, while Western cultures are no suitable for democracy, and Eastern cultures need dictators, sort of things were said. I found somehow this understanding that these people have a culture which can be so different that everything can be seen from outside in their own categories. This is, you will have to think about it. And when I was listening to you, I was reminded of a writer called Mario Puzo, when he wrote Godfather, where everything boiled down to the fear factor, with the Don or the local people, local Don or local powerful people used to control everything. Everybody was under the pressure. Last but not the least, hypothetically, I may ask you, are you suggesting that the money factor is the key factor? If money factor is the key factor, then if the central stops...
Sorry, if you ask me one question, I can give you...
No.
Yes, I agree with that. But I want to answer to all questions.
One line, sir. Just one line. If money is the factor...
No.
The factor. If it's... I mean, money cannot be that important.
Money is one of the factors. That is what I have mentioned.
Just one. What I found missing in this entire interpretation of things there is the political interference. You said at one point of the presentation that they were innocent people.
They were.
And they are now seen as people whose culture facilitates corruption. What is the story behind it? Who is responsible for this? I want you to category come on it. Who is responsible for the corruption of innocent people? One, and what is the way out? Because these things are very, very important. Because the scholar...
It is the politicians.
Are you saying this in this paper? Because you are actually saying that these things are to be managed, and management factor is being given primacy into it. If you put the pressure on the anguish of the people, then interpretation would be different. But if you put the entire thing on the issue of corruption and linking it to the culture of that region, then entire interpretation goes into a different direction.
Sir, the thing is that...
I may be wrong, but...
No. When I say, no, it's not the question of wrong. The thing is that...
The impression I got that.
Yeah. The thing is that, see, I have clearly mentioned it is one of the reasons for encouraging corruption. Now, if you ask me, your first question was about politics.
The importance of culture.
Importance of culture. That was the first question you raised.
Can any culture encourage corruption?
Encourage corruption. That is why I told that such a study has not been done in India, but in abroad, yes, it has done. Clickguard says, cultures with stronger family ties were likely to experience public sector corruption than those with weaker family ties. Then another author, Gonzalez Trejo, mentions that culture and corruptions are significantly correlated. Then Babatunde says, corruption in Nigeria is more cultural than political. Then Rodrigo says, national culture played an important contextual role in causing corruption. So what I mean to say is that such studies are there, but not in India. That is what I need to say. So, and another thing, the findings which I have got, it is only based on the secondary data, 41 literature, and the primary data from 142 respondents. Now, 142 respondents, if you ask me whether that finding can be applied to the entire population, no, it cannot be. But because of constraint of time, because during the winter break only, we can go out and carry out field work. So this was what I did.
Dr. Nambiar, Can you explain how those 142 people were selected?
It was
not the number. It is the selection process.
It was accidental random sampling. Means I know that this kind of
you're saying accidental random sampling, is it? What is accidental random sampling? I have never heard of it.
No. Yes, it is the accidental. Means we are going to a place, and meeting the people who come across and then asking questions. But this was not like that. The thing is that I will say, as you said, it is a purposive random sampling, maybe you can call like that. The thing is that I decided that I will go to these places. I will not interview the police officers who are not ready to talk with me. I cannot do that. When I went to them, already I had talked with those people, but when I went to them, they said that you should not quote us. My name should not be there. Then the alternative was
okay,
that...
Okay. What I am trying to say is this is not random sampling at all. This is subjective sampling. Totally subjective sampling. Nothing random about it.
You can call it as purposive sampling. This is my purpose. I have some purpose in my mind. And with that purpose, I have gone to a certain place. And considering the situation prevailing over there, I got the information from the people, those who are ready to talk with me.
This is a highly biased sample. Very highly subjectively biased. No academic conclusions can be drawn from it. That would be my submission.
Okay, if you think like that, I don't think so.
Ask Medha, what's your opinion, Medha? Do you do some sampling theory?
Sir, there are certain situations in which you cannot pre-decide, these are the people whom I want to interview. And if those people...
There are techniques. When the subject matter is sensitive, supposing I am asking about somebody's sex life and I don't want that particular person to give up. I mean, he's afraid. You know, he wants to keep it private. There are techniques of doing sampling under those circumstances. We teach it in class at the MSc level. So you can employ those techniques. For example, you take a biased dice and then that person throws the dice and then he gives a yes-no answer. Based on the bias of that dice, you can get an impression for the population. But you can't get any individual answer whether it is true or false. So there are ways of ensuring the privacy and the secrecy of the sample. But this is purely subjective sampling. And this is not something, you know, it can have enormous amount of bias. I think Medha would like to say something, would she?
Enormous, it cannot be. Because I told you, it's just 142 sample. It is not a massive sample. Because for proving
such
the theory,
samples don't have to be very large. The question is, all sample can be very accurate, but it should be a random sample. It should be a representative sample, not just a subjective sample. Subjective sampling can lead to wild errors.
Sir, the situation in which you are going and the people whom you are meeting and collecting information, I agree. I believe that this is one of the ways in which I can carry out my study. If you don't believe, okay, it's for you.
There's a way. I am not denying that is a way. But don't call it random sampling or don't call it, because you are not applying sampling theory. You cannot apply sampling theory if your sample is not random. That's the problem. You can say, I have anecdotal evidence, I have this, I have that, and I'm using it. That is fair. That is legitimate. But it's not random sampling.
Professor Paranjpe wants to say something.
Yeah, I. The only thing I wanted to say, which I hinted at the beginning, was that the study has certain, so to speak, statistical and quantitative parameters and dimensions. And it also has certain analytical, descriptive, narrative, and qualitative components. And how these two jive or gel is not clear methodologically. And since Dr. Nambiya started his presentation with research methodology, I think that, you know, this relationship between the components that he has assembled needs to be clarified, in my view. And I tend to agree with Professor Raju that it's not an invalid sample, sir. Because even if you go and interview people purposively, if you identify a set of people whom you think are going to be useful native informants or people who are in the know of things, information thus gathered is not invalid in research. That's not the point. I think the point is it should not be labeled as a random sample. You should label it differently. And now that I listen to you, I think it's much more qualitative, much more subjective than you seem to indicate at the beginning. And the tables and the statistics. See, what happens often is in order to prop up our research, in social studies, we try to be very close to mathematics or science, which we need not be. That is the point, because a lot of the data is being managed and massaged, as Professor Raju will tell you. The hundreds and thousands of ways in which that is done. And I think he will tell you that social science is not a science. I mean, you talk to him in detail. I don't want to go into it. So what I'm trying to say is that if you can clarify some of your methodological assumptions, as you finish your work, because you work so hard. And having said that, I want to make only one more point. I think others will have more things to say, like Medha Tai, who does, a lot of sampling in her work. The other thing that struck me is that, you brought in a very important point, which I missed in the abstract, which is that by corruption, you don't just mean, people appropriating or skimming off or taking commissions like fodder scam, this, that, and the other, but actually the state paying off people, or that states within states, that certain people actually levying taxes. I saw that actually when I visited what used to be, previous to Jharkhand, Bihar and all, we were told not to go near Dhanbad and all. We were told don't travel on this road after 6 p.m. There'll be a tax. People will stop your car and you'll have to pay a certain tax to the people who control that area. Otherwise, your life or whatever, life or limb will be threatened. So I think that what I'm trying to simply say is that the idea of corruption should be widened. It's not a simple kind of corruption that we assume goes on, almost anywhere in India. But this is something different, okay? This is like a state within a state with its own apparatus of levying taxes and even dispensing justice, So these were just my observations, okay? I think others will have things to say. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Professor Singh is...
If I may add one point, when you are making a correlation, when you make a correlation based on a non-random sample, there can be problems.
Okay.
You are, because it is going to be a very contentious.
Professor Singh, please.
Dr. Nambiar has done a new kind of study in one sense. That he has gone to the field, the ground, the zero ground zero, and try to talk to the people. I agree with Professor Raju that it's not a random sample. It's a purposive convenience sample. Purposive convenience sample. You have a certain purpose that you want to meet certain categories of people. That's one purpose. Another purpose is to not miss out certain kinds of people. So you have purposes of research that guides your sample. And it's a convenient sample. Whosoever you come across and whosoever is willing to talk to them. So it's not really a random sample. It's a purposive convenience sample. And the high power statistical techniques that you have used, they can be applied only to the kind of data that fulfill certain specific characteristics, like correlation and particularly regression analysis, cannot be applied to any kind of data. Your kind of data is not amenable to this powerful statistical technique of regression analysis. Your kind of data is more amenable to qualitative study. Qualitative study, fieldwork study, a kind of fieldwork study in which administrators, political leaders, or students or teachers are studied, and it's a kind of participant observation, actual meeting with them, and collecting data. And the quantitative techniques require a kind of precise statistical precision, statistical kind of data that can be analyzed through correlation coefficient or regression analysis. That's one thing. And if I were you, I would apply qualitative kind of approach to the problem. It's a new kind of a study that I have not really come across. You have referred to 141 or such secondary analysis, which appeared to be the kind of a study that you have done, right? Or are they of different kind?
No, the secondary data, that was 41 literature.
Uh-huh.
And this primary data, that is 142.
But most of the studies I have come across are by scholars who have studied at the level of leadership, at the level of leadership of insurgencies, at the level of leadership of political parties, administrators, I recall listening to a very enlightening, amazing lecture by a recent Home Secretary, by Menon by name. I'm forgetting his initials. It's not the Menon who assisted Sardar Patel. I was looking for his name. I don't find this. These net sources have also become so inefficient that such a scholar, Menon. I listened to his lecture in IDSA, he knows the Northeast like the palm of his hand. He's also a Keralaite, and you may like to meet him. He was a recent Home Secretary. Another thing that I would like to say is that, of course, it's beyond your approach. Perhaps a comparative study of Nagaland and Mizoram could yield some very insightful results, because Mizoram is one state where, after the 1985 Mizo Accord, peace has returned, democracy has returned, a very vibrant civil society has come into existence in Mizoram. Nagaland is the mother of all insurgencies in the Northeast, the earliest insurgencies which has defied any solution so far. One of the most important leaders with whom the Prime Minister has been talking is a Naga from Manipur, Moiwa. But he is not from Nagaland. He is a Naga from Manipur, but he's leading the entire Naga, demand, Naga nationalist demand, and I have come across such a study, and the Prime Minister has come to a framework agreement with Muriwa
2015.
But it was not made public by the government. It was not made public by Muriwa, and now it has become public, and the kind of demands that are being made are not acceptable to the government of India. Given what has happened in Jammu and Kashmir, one cannot grant a subnational separate constitution for Nagaland.
Flag.
A separate flag for Nagaland. So that demand is simply beyond the ken of acceptability within the framework of the Indian constitution. And the Indian constitution is the framework within which the government of India is prepared to talk. And Muriwa got upset because Prime Minister or the government of India tried to approach some smaller Naga groups also. Ravi, the governor, who was then a negotiator, he started talking to smaller Naga groups, and Muriwa got upset. And that may be the reason why the whole framework agreement of 2015 has been tossed by the Naga leaders. And I don't know what would be the fate of that agreement. And the kind of demand that the Nagas have, they want a state of the Nagas, and the population they aim at is partly in Nagaland, partly in Manipur, partly in Burma or Myanmar, and
Nagali, greater Nagali.
And partly in Arunachal Pradesh. How can that kind of federal integration, or how can that kind of federal union, Belgium has that kind of federation, where people living, the three linguistic communities living in any part of Belgium, they have first a territorial federation of three states, and the second component of federation is a community federation, linguistic community federation, whereby French or Dutch and the Germans, wherever they may be, in three provinces and the capital region, wherever they may be, they are part of that community federation, so territorial federation as well as community federation. That kind of model can apply to the kind of demand that the Nagas are making. Of course, Burma cannot, Myanmar is a foreign country that cannot be included. So, I'm familiar with this kind of study, and I was impressed by your attempt to go to the ground zero and study the people themselves. If I were you, I would have used qualitative method, long dialogue with the people, participant observation, but the condition you describe perhaps make it impossible for you to use even qualitative method authentically. So, these are some thoughts that came to my mind, and I thought that I should frankly share my views with you. If you consider them of any use, you can accept them, you can reject them. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable suggestions. She wanted to ask something.
Okay.
Who's that?
She has to unmute from her side. Dr. Suhas Nambiar, you may ask your question. by unmuting yourself.
She raised the hand.
Okay. In the meantime, let's ask Professor Harda. Please.
संस्कृति शब्द का जिस तरह आप व्यवहार उससे भी जानती होती है कि नागा प्रजाति या स्वभाव और संस्कार से सदियों से
Nowhere did they say that. Okay, yeah, yeah.
मुझे लगता है कि इसके लिए किसी ऐतिहासिक परिप्रेक्ष्य की जरूरत है जैसे कि अभी प्रचार शब्द का व्यवहार वे ऑफ लाइफ मुझे लगता है कि ये टाइम फ्रेम में किसी परिस्थिति हो आप जैसा आपने आपकी अपनी स्थापना है कि आतंकवाद के कारण तो ये वे ऑफ लाइफ को संस्कृति कहता मुझे लगता है कि थोड़ी सी भ्रांति यदि आप संस्कृति शब्द का व्यवहार भी कर रहे हैं तो मुझे लगता है कि एक ऐतिहासिक परिप्रेक्ष्य दिया जाना चाहिए मुझे लगता है कि पूरी मुझे लगता है कि हमारे भारतीय भ्रांति की महत्वपूर्ण जाति उसको सांस्कृतिक दृष्टि से कल्चरली स्वभाव और संस्कार से दृष्टि कह देना थोड़ा मैं चाहता हूं कि आप ये स्पष्ट करें कि ये परिस्थिति जब आतंकवाद की शुरुआत हुई उसके बाद ये शुरू मुझे लगता है इसके बिना पूरा परिदृश्य बनेगा
Sir, history as far as you told me, I have already referred it. Yeah, okay, I have referred it in my past presentations. Then, nowhere did they say that it is the culture which has got relationship with corruption. I said culture, certain elements of culture has been one of the factors that caused corruption in government offices. This is what I mentioned everywhere. I hope so.
Culture का जहाँ तक बात है मैं आपको एक एग्जाम्पल देता हूँ इवन जो पोलिटिकल पार्टी वर्कर्स होते हैं दे ऑल्सो एक्सपेक्ट देयर लीडर टू डू एवरीथिंग व्हाट दे वांट और अगर नहीं करते हैं एक केदारनाथ सामने होते थे चीफ एग्जीक्यूटिव काउंसिल ऑफ दिल्ली तो उनका नियमानुसार नाम कार्यकर्ताओं ने रखा था Because he said that no, it will be through the rules. I will not go beyond the rules. Karyakarta has kept his name in the rules. So that is also some kind of a part of a culture. If our son becomes an IAS, he will not do the work of the people of the village, wrong or right, then his esteem is reduced. Then no one asks.
That is right. But what I mean to say is these are some of the elements that caused. It doesn't mean that I am blaming the entire culture as such, but certain elements. That's what I.
So may I add that we think culture is a very amorphous and fluid term, and it's subject to change over time. And we always tend to associate culture as a term with only positive notions, as Searle's work has demonstrated that, you know, what he means by culture is a tradition. Rather than that physical association of Sanskriti. Like sir, अगर आप कहीं पे भी आप दिल्ली में जाएंगे तो एक नाके वाले का जो हर रेट बंधा होता है that is also part of culture. जितना भी वो क्रॉस करेगा जितनी भी रेड लाइट वो उसको देना ही है that is also part of culture.
शायद हिंदी में जो संस्कृति का अर्थ है वो ट्रेडिशन
है सर वहां पे वो पुलिस वालों का बंधा हुआ है वो और मैं दिल्ली एज अ कैपिटल की बात आपको बता रही हूँ
लॉ को तोड़ना भी कल्चर है दिल्ली
यस सर आई मीन वो एवरीवेयर इट इज नॉट स्पेसिफिक टू दिल्ली अगर किसी को भी रेड लाइट
वे ऑफ लाइफ
सर वे ऑफ प्लीज जस्ट वन मिनट सर वे ऑफ लाइफ वही तो मैंने मेंशन किया है पीपल से दैट यस इट इज वे ऑफ लाइफ
सर ज्यादा मद्रास दिल्ली बैक टू गोवा
I noticed that in Delhi, on ladies' seat, male would occupy it and the lady would stand by, yes, and would not, and the seat would not be vacated. In Calcutta, the males would vacate the lady's seat if a lady comes. And in Madras, the lady's seat in the buses would be left vacant and the male would just stand by. So culture varies from the place to place. And of course, you know, in a place like Nagaland, which has been which has been in insurgency and, you know, revolt, insurgency for so long, the culture had become so subject to transformation that the culture that you will use in a stable tribal society would not be applicable to that kind of society where culture has lost all its elements, all its clues, the relationships have got so distorted, so disturbed that the world, the concept of culture would not be applicable to that. So, you know, with these, you know, sensitivity, you know, you may perhaps approach your research. Of course, it would not be wrong to say, it would not be proper to say that there is no culture in Nagaland. It would not be proper to say. Because, you know, in spite of all kinds of disturbances, tribal culture is so close to the heart of the people that they would not like to part with it. So your concept, your use of the concept may also be defended here.
He's been patient. Sir, please.
Thank you. I think Paul worked out research for that. I could feel that it will show up with those kind of figures and representations. Thank you. I think it's going to be a huge resource for people like me and then others at large and beyond. So thank you for doing this work. Just some quick observations and comments that is pointed out by Professor Singh, that we can be a little more sensitive in the way we present our views to the louder, larger audience, because one who is not acquainted with this kind of studies or other culture, there is high possibility that the whole thing will be misrepresented. So I suggest that we want to be more sensible. The next thing is, I think I could agree with many of the figures that you projected. My suggestion is that there should be some kind of framework in which you locate this kind of figure. It cannot be generalized. That's what I would like to suggest. And for that kind of locating this discourse in some context, I welcome Professor Pippen's remark as to be located in historical context. Without this historical context, the whole thing can be blown out of proportion. So I just want to take one or two points. For example, you say people have accepted corruption as a way of life. I don't think I accept it. I don't think none of the 142 people that we have corresponded with have accepted in the sense positively, yes, we like it, we embrace it. I think they are all trying to say that this has been their practice, but none of them would say, I welcome it. They have not accepted. They are only out of frustration, they may be pointing out that so frustrated, so pathetic, our people have accepted. But when we really look at it, I don't think that more people have accepted. I don't think I have accepted. I don't think none of the 142 people that we have corresponded with accepted. So this kind of phrasing or terms, I think is also important. What the problematic every location again, the way you know, it has criminal groups, I would contest with that idea, and which you say it has emerged recently. Can you name one group which has emerged recently? None of them has emerged or evolved or formed recently. They have been there. The point is, for so long, they have not been speaking. Because no amount of speaking, either by the political groups, public, or any group trying to get the attention of the government, has been heard. The Indian government themselves. No one's voice has been heard. Only the ceasefire agreement some time back, and then this agreement recently, 2015. Then people started voicing out. All these, which were silent for so long, so they have not been able to do something. And they are not criminal groups. I would strongly contest to that idea. When you look at the history, actually, it's a people's movement. It's no group, actually. So when the movement started, the idea is that every 10 houses will support one fighter. It's a people's movement. There was no concept of heads. People from each house contributes to this movement. Only when the so-called Shillong Accord went wrong, resulting in the formation of NSCN, as you were saying, which requires people mandate. But people in general were not given the kind of mandate that they needed. They need resources. Where do they get the resource? That's why they have resorted to this kind of imposition or tax or whatever you call it. So I think it's important to look at this kind of figure in the context. Context is very important. Personally, I've written one paper on corruption in Nagaland. I don't know whether it was my work or not. It was published in 2018, where I was trying to exactly problematize this concept of corruption. I think largely I'm in agreement with you. There's important correlation between culture and corruption. But the manner in which we ended part of this, because here I'm afraid to derive any conclusion. I just discuss and say it's too early to define corruption from a studies perspective, from any perspective. So I problematize this whole notion of corruption, and then giving my own culturalist interpretation to it and say that no, it's difficult to define corruption unless you locate all these within the culture, within the history, and that's how I can get that my paper. You can give it a look if you want. So that's some of my big, small observations.
Okay.
You may or may not respond to it.
No, I agree. No. In simple terms, corruption means misuse of official power. In simple terms. That may be in any way. I never said that means it's only accepting or giving money. It can be in any way. That is one thing. Second thing, you said that there is no criminal gangs. I can show you law, several literature which says that after the NSCN, several criminals, gangs, groups have mushroomed up, and they claim that they are also from NSCN, and they threaten people and extract money, extort money. Do you agree that the extorting money and the collection of illegal taxation that is happening in Nagaland, criminals are not involved in that?
What also our director has said, will you plan this as corruption? So, corruption has so many shades and certain points to make. That's why it's not easy to define corruption from one perspective and generalize it to actually all forms of life or practices. That's the point I want to
make. Yeah. See, I have not gone to generalize the findings of 142 people or the 41 literature on the entire Naga community. But what I got from these 41 literature and 142 respondents and the research that I got from discussion with the different authorities, that is what I mentioned. Now, no, the thing is that the question is, yes, certainly you are right that you have to go to the common people and talk to them.
No, somebody.
The thing is that the situation there is such that we cannot go out and, yes, I told you my experience, what the police officers were saying. You can't go and talk to those people like that. No, the only thing is, from the sample that I got and the literature, this is what it shows. And I never said that the entire culture of Nagas are like that. No. Certain... I am talking to everybody. Certain elements, it did encourage corruption in government offices. This is what I meant to say. Thank you.
Enlighten myself on your field of research there. Whenever elections are held in Nagaland, a very high percentage of electoral turnout is seen in every election. In every election. So, on the one side, there is insurgency. On the other side, there is very high party participation in democratic process. Like, I am puzzled by this.
How it is happening. Yeah, I ask this question to some people. They say that, see, who will not come for voting if they are getting money? One. Second thing, they say that their education level is high, so people are aware. See, the thing is that even if people, I have mentioned in my paper at two places, that it is the
official language of Nagaland. Everyone knows English.
What I was talking that at two places I have mentioned voting, something else I wanted to mention, just now I'm forgetting that. So yes, something else.
Can I just a couple of observations. One is just like culture doesn't always have positive corruption, corruption also and you know this dualism of innocent and corrupt, you know, I think one needs to revisit that. I think that is not that even within tribal forms corruption is not bad. Interesting. I mean corrupt, like corruption can be problematic. Like I'm just saying the thing is that in many cases corruption helps people to, you know, circumnavigate some very strict state rules to lead a better life, right? And the question arises, why not? Right? And so always looking at corruption in a negative sense, right? That would be, that would help us, and that would see that, you know, we are coming from a particular place. So maybe, you know, always looking at corruption in a negative way wouldn't be, you know, fruitful in a sense. And also because, you know, innocence is also a very problematic term, because, you know, no one is innocent. I mean, there are very few people who are innocent. Even, the discourse of someone coming and corrupting is a little problematic. And my final point is, like, you know, it's a your perspective in a sense, it helps a lot for people who are, you know, going and studying in that particular space, right? For example, if someone, if an NDPS officer had written something about, you know, about cannabis in some places, it would have been very helpful for people like me, for further researchers, right? You know, to study what people from a state, who have worked for the state, the kind of perspective they bring in a particular problem or in a particular situation. So in that way, I feel the work is very important. And so does the culture.
Thank you. I just want to ask you a question. Do you believe that corruption is good or bad? simple.
Sir, it's a complex question for me. It may be bad in some cases. It depends on situation. And it's not that it is always bad. That is.
So if it is not, if it is not bad always, then don't you think that it can lead to create inequality in the society?
No, sir, I don't think. In fact, in many times people navigate inequality through corruption.
Okay, thank you. Yes,
yeah, Sanjit, you are being interrogated now.
Yeah. So.
Sir.
Yes. No, after this intervention of Musa, I think misuse of power would have been a better term for corruption. And then again, you will have to think about who is misusing the power and what purposes. And then again, you have to bring in the context. And the context determines many things. And in case of Nagaland, as like some bit of familiarity with the literature available on that. I think this whole treatment of yours, as far as impressions are concerned, it's facts of some kind of a bias, and that bias can be dispelled if you can be more sensitive and somehow try to put focus on the context rather than bringing here the Naxals, Vietnam, and all kind of things. Why I'm saying so? Because this has something to do with the ignorance about common educated people about the issues related to Malala, as Anusha was referring to. This notion that it was a popular movement is missing somehow. In the historical literature, we always tend to see that these movements were the handiworks of people like Fizeau and others, and it was kind of a conspiracy in which foreign powers were involved. Now, it might have come into the play the way corruption comes into it. So, as a scholar, I would suggest that it would be better if you be more careful about. Because we hardly have other side's story coming from them. So whatever we have, we can be a little bit open. And as it was, you are working on a subject in which we all are interested. And everybody has shown interest in your work. It's very important work. If you can bring that kind of filter into it, then it could have been a better type of work and more acceptable. It's very important and difficult. I do agree that it's a difficult
one. In support of Dr. Patel, I would like to say that there is an American public administration expert, Fred W. Riggs, writes that in new democracy, in order to build up political party, vis-a-vis bureaucracy is already well entrenched in the state, very powerful, and in order to build political parties, a certain degree of corruption is positive.
But yes. Sir, this is not a certain degree of corruption I am talking about.
This is a power.
निवेश काल में उनको करप्शन ये लगता है कि बाद में अभी भी उसको अपराध की श्रेणी में ही माना जा रहा है उसको करप्शन की श्रेणी में जैसे आपने रास्ता सुरक्षित दे दिया उसकी टिक कर लिया जाता था आदिवासी जाति उसको करप्शन की श्रेणी में मान दिया तो मुझे लगता है कि एक ये भी देखा जाना चाहिए कि उनकी प्रथाओं का हिस्सा है या करप्शन या
Yes, Anjali ji, I wanted to say one thing. Anjali ji, just yes, one sir. Minute.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, the thing I wanted to flag, Dr. Nambiar, is a lot of people have mentioned this issue of culture and corruption. I think the point is that your work should not seem to be, targeting, stereotyping, or ethnocentric towards the Naga people. I think that you have to manage to convey in such a way that it does not send that kind of, though I don't think that's what you mean. I'm just making a point that the concern has come so many times that you have to be able to state your position with a certain degree of finesse and nuance so that it does not seem as if you're targeting any specific culture. Do you get my point?
Yes.
That is one because
there is no question of targeting anybody.
Yeah, yeah. I agree. I'm not saying you are doing it. I'm saying that I'm just listening to the comments.
Yes.
Over and over again, there is a red flag being raised about corruption, its various meanings, another red flag being raised about culture and the correlation between the two. So I think your work is unique because hardly anybody has done the sort of work you've done. But, you know, it will fall easy prey to those who say, look, this is stereotyping. This is ethnocentrism. This is not valid. So I'm just alerting you to something because as academics, we have to be sensitive. That's my only point, you know. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
That's one. That's a kind of curiosity. Do you think there is a deliberate intention on the part of the central government to let corruption produce?
It was done by them only.
Thank you.
No, it was
so not. Far, I don't know correctly, because despite the large scale corruption taking place, here is where I'm saying, in agreement with you for all these terrorist states and whatever you call I don't know any one of the arrested because of CBI inquiry. Asking year after year for CBI inquiry. No inquiry.
The thing is that, see, especially after the statehood, when the central government started to, I read in that the people of the officials, they started to, in the beginning, they were having certain hesitations, but later on they found that they are the masters of money. And in that way, they started to ask for more. They started to get more. So it is a fact that, yes, it is a made thing. But the thing is that the common people, those who are coming in contact with the public office, everybody has to come in contact with government offices. So they are the people, they are the sufferers because of all these things.
So indirect anxiety.
There are middle class. No, what do you mean by that? See, I was
rich or poor. There are either rich or poor.
No, who are maybe the employees? They need money. If they are getting easy money, who will forego that?
I will.
If nobody else has any further questions, let's all congratulate Dr. Nambiar for the presentation, excellent presentation, and also
thank
for
you.
The near completion of this project. Many congratulations, sir. And we have got lots of good feedback. So please incorporate it. And also,
thank you, but before leaving.
May I complete, sir?
Yeah, please come.
Please add in more gray areas into your work. Blacks and white.
Yes.
Is, you need to elaborate and more sensitize.
Certainly.
Thank you.
This is my final presentation. So before leaving this platform, I want to thank Dr. Anjali Duhan for consenting to chair my session.
Thank you for giving me this
opportunity. I bow my head in front of the soul of Dr. S. Radhakrishnan for his vision to have such an institution, due to which I am here today. I express my heartfelt gratitude to the selection committee of the IAS for permitting to conduct a study of this nature here. I am highly thankful to all the staff of library, ARO, admin, account branch, estate branch, and mess for making my stay and study here comfortable. I am also grateful to Mr. Johnny and Mr. Rajesh Kumar for all their helps when I was in room number 114 and presently in room number 27. Finally, I am always indebted for the moral support extended to me by my wife, Dr. Suhas, my daughter Suprabha, and my son Srirup, without which I could not have been able to fulfill my responsibilities here satisfactorily. Thank you. Thank you very much for giving me a patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
Which element of corruption?